birthday to Bill. Good morning. Good to see everybody out. And can y'all hear me better when I get this close? A little bit. Okay. Good to see everybody here, and glad you made it out for church this week. Welcome to the visitors, and glad you can be with us. Let's see, we'll start off our service the way we do a lot of weeks with some praises. If anybody has a praise you'd like to mention, now's your chance.
I'm glad to be back. Glad my mom is a lot stronger.
Good to have you back.
I'm glad to be back. Praise God. Just
healing touch. Yes, ma'am. That's right. Got a lot. Got back. Been missing y'all. So glad you can be here.
I'm glad Bill can pass the stone.
There you go. Another thing I want to say that I'm 60 years old today, and I came into this church. I was dating some young blonde girl, and kind of stuck with her for a little while. That turned into a long time. But
and you forgot her name, huh?
No, I know her name. God knows her name too. But the time that I've been at this church means a whole lot to me, and this church means a whole lot to me too.
Happy birthday. Anybody else? You know, we're pretty blessed to be able to be at church each week, the way our world is right now, and so we're thankful for that, too. Anybody else? Look to our announcements for this week. On Wednesday, we'll have our midweek Bible study at 7 p.m. And the children will be meeting next door. Children's church workers are there on the screen. And then you see the Christmas dinner is actually next Sunday, 6 o'clock. And that is going to be catered, correct? Mm-hmm. Yes, that's going to be a catered meal. And so please come out for that. Be out in Fellowship Hall, 6 p.m., our Christmas dinner. Thanks again to everybody that helped out with the nativity in any way. There was a lot of work that goes into that thing, and a lot of people enjoyed it and had a lot of good comments from it. So glad anybody that could participate was able to. And that's sort of our big project in around Christmas time, and so it was a pretty good success again. Sunday school, we've gotten into the book of Luke pretty good, and this week's lesson was really good again. I encourage you to be part of that if you can, especially as we go through the Christmas season, but all year round. Bible study is so important for us. Anybody else have announcements that you'd like to mention?
We're
going to be practicing with the children this morning during children's church.
And
do a little.
A little.
Okay. Anything else?
Shame.
So are you going to start, you're going to introduce everything and start us off, or is that going to be me again?
Go ahead.
We always plan ahead so well. So we're going to sing a few songs this morning. Good to see everyone once again. Tim's going to lead this first one. just because apparently he loves a song and he likes to play guitar on it. So we're going to sing some songs to praise our Savior for the gift of sending his son to die on the cross. So please rise and let's sing together.
Everybody likes to take a holiday. Everybody likes to take a rest. Spending time together with the family, sharing lots of love and happiness. Come on, ring those bells, shine the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells, everybody say, Jesus, we remember it's your birthday. Celebrations come because of something good. Celebrations we love to become. Mary had a baby born in Bethlehem. The greatest celebration of them all. Those bells light the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells, everybody say, Jesus, we remember it's your birthday. Come on, ring those bells, light the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells.
Amen. Thank you, Tim.
Echoing their joy. divine, brighter and brighter he will shine. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawns. Jesus is now
be seated.
Matthew 2:10-11. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down and worshipped him. And when they opened their treasures and present gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Thank you. And now, if you'll stand and greet someone that's close to you, tell them you're glad to see them today, and then our ushers will please come.
Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, it is so good to be in your house today. Father, the season of the year, Lord, is something we should never forget, and that's the birth of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who came to save us from our sins. Father, we just thank you for each one that has come today, Lord, to worship you, for you are so worthy of worship. We just pray that they'll receive a blessing today. Father, we just ask as we take up this offering that you will bless the gift and bless the giver. We love you, Lord Jesus. In your sweet and wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Go to see my son, this manger for
Will you please stand for the reading? This morning we're in Luke chapter 1, verses 63 through 80. And he asked for a writing tablet and wrote, saying, "His name is John." So they all marveled. Immediately his mouth was open and his tongue loosed, and he spoke, praising God. Then fear came on all who dwelt around them, and all these things were discussed throughout all of the hill country of Judea. And all of those who heard them kept them in their hearts, saying, "What kind of child will this be?" And the hand of the Lord was with him. Now his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, "Blessed is the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people, and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets, who have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all of the days of our lives. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins, through their tender mercy of our God, and which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace." So the child grew and became strong in spirit and was in the deserts till the day of the manifestation to Israel. May God bless the reading of his word. May be seated. Before we go into a time of prayer, are there any requests to be spoken? Any other spoken?
I have several.
Please remember the kids and the teachers as we go back to full virtual. A lot of upset kids right now and stressed out teachers, so just remember them. All right, let's pray. Father God, we just thank you for this time of year and thank you for the gift of your son and what it means and what will become Easter that we're building up to. And we just thank you for that salvation that it grants, dear God. We just pray for all these requests that were brought before you this morning. You know each and every one before they were spoken, but we pray in faith that you will hear us and that your will be done. We pray for everything that's going on in this country, in this world, and we just know that your hand is in it, and we just pray for our patience that we can still look to you and just watch for you and listen for your word and have your guidance. We pray for our service this morning. Be with Mr. Tim as he brings the word, have him speak the words that you have him to bring forth, and let us have open ears and open hearts to hear this message. We just thank you for our community. Thank you for the outpouring of support that we've had, and we just pray that we're able to go out and be that light and the word out in the community and the world that you would have us to be. So forgive us of our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices.
That candle's going to burn. There we go. I remember one time a number of years ago, we were doing a wedding. I was not in charge. But they decided that the thing to do was to pre-burn all the candles. Somebody had said they would burn better if you pre-burned them. So they did that. It's when you used to have the candelabras, you know, with 49 candles behind you. So they lit all the candles. And it worked really good until they got ready to light them again. And I thought the poor ushers were never going to get through. They would light, they'd go out. They'd light, they'd go out. They'd light, they'd go out. And by the time they finally got them lit, everybody that was sitting in the congregation was howling. So it was thankfully the bride was out back and she didn't know anything about it. So I don't even remember whose wedding it was. They probably remember, but I don't. Good morning. It's good to see you. I'm glad that you are here. Today is the third Sunday in Advent. Next Sunday will be the fourth Sunday in Advent, Lord willing, and then the week after that will be Christmas. So before we know it, we will be celebrating Christmas. We've spent the time through these weeks in different ways looking at how we ought to celebrate Christmas and the birth of Jesus. The last two Sundays, we've considered messages called the promise of Christmas. Last week, we talked about the purpose of Christmas. This morning, I want to talk about the problem with Christmas. I heard a story about a church that was putting on their annual Christmas pageant, and the junior high Sunday school class was responsible for most of the parts in the pageant. And the teacher had assigned many of the parts. A lot of them were, of course, not speaking parts, which were pretty popular. You could just pretend to be a shepherd and stand in the corner. But there were three major parts, one being Mary and Joseph, and then the innkeeper. Well, there were two eighth grade boys that desperately wanted to be Joseph. It was not because they particularly wanted to be Joseph, but because Mary was the best looking girl in the eighth grade Sunday school class. And so they were kind of vying for the spot. Well, the teacher chose one of them, not realizing the competition that was there. And they did their practice. And each evening they would come in and she gave the other eighth grade boy the job of being the innkeeper. So in their practice, each time it went smoothly, they would come and Mary and Joseph would come and knock on the door. The innkeeper would come to the door and say, "I'm sorry, there's no room in the inn," and everything moved on like it's supposed to. But the guy that was the innkeeper was not happy. And so the night of the pageant, when Mary and Joseph show up and knock at the door, instead of saying his appointed line, he said, "Sure, come on in. We've got plenty of room." Well, Joseph didn't know exactly what to do. But being pretty quick on his feet, he thought, he poked his head in the door and looked around. He said, "This place is a dump. I'd never let my wife sleep there. Come on, Mary, let's go sleep in the barn." Have you ever noticed that Christmas doesn't ever turn out exactly like you want it to? You probably have seen some of the videos on television or on the internet of children doing pageants and doing their own kind of thing. There was one little boy that was a part of his pageant, and they were singing along, and when they got through singing his appointed Christmas carol, he broke into "All My Exes Live in Texas." And of course, the teacher comes and grabs him off the stage quickly, and most all of us at one time or another have been involved in something like that. The problem is that no matter how hard we plan and how hard we try, Christmas never seems to turn out quite perfect. In fact, Elvis had one of the biggest hits ever with Christmas songs, with one called "I'll Have a Blue Christmas." A blue Christmas. Now imagine, of all the times of the year that we ought not to be blue, that we ought to be happy, we ought to be joyful, is Christmas. But the truth is that for many people, Christmas is not the happiest time of the year. You see, there'll be many people that this year we'll be celebrating for the first time Christmas without someone who was very special to them in their life. Across the days of this year, they've lost someone that was a close loved one. Psychologists and those that deal with those kinds of things tell us that when a person experiences grief for someone that they love dearly, it takes at least a year for them to work their way through it, because you have all the first. You have the first Mother's Day or Father's Day or birthday or all of those things, your first summer vacation, and then your first Christmas without that person. And no matter how you try, it somehow impacts it a little bit. Well, there's all kinds of things happening like that. In fact, Christmas depression, while it is temporary, is actually a diagnosed disease. They have, a name for it. It's called SAD, seasonal affective disorder. And it is actually a diagnosed a situation where a person has such a gloomy feeling about the holiday because of factors in their life. Now, it may be because of the death of a loved one. It might be because of just how things are going on in your life. Imagine how many people this year may experience that. This is 2020. I mean, we have had so many things happen through this year. Even if it was not something directly in your life, you just feel like you're a part of a world that's kind of out of sync. Well, in spite of the fact that we kind of dress it up and make it seem that way, the first Christmas was not perfect at all either. If you can imagine what was happening in the minds and the hearts of Mary as she discovered that she was going to be the mother of the Lord when an angel appeared to her, and she knew that she was not married, and she knew she had never been with a man, and she in fact told the angel, "That's impossible, it can't happen," until the angel said, "With God, nothing's impossible." And Mary's response was, "Well, let it happen to me, or let it be to me exactly as you have said. I will be faithfully obedient to whatever God calls me to do." That was the first step in Christmas really happening. And then Joseph. Well, what about this poor guy? He's dreamed maybe a long part of his life about the time that he finally would meet the young lady he wanted to marry. And of course, in that day, it was a little different than it is now. And rather than asking her, would she marry him? He went and asked her dad, would she marry him? Girls, wouldn't you love that situation to still be going around now that you had not much to do about it? You just go and ask dad and say, "Sure, marry the guy. It's fine with me." But that was the situation. And yet before they get married, during the period of betrothal, we find out that Mary's going to have a baby, and Joseph knew it was not his. And so here they are, and they're experiencing the gossip from friend and family. They're experiencing the unease about what's going on in their own life. What's God really doing in my life? Then all of a sudden, just to cap it all off, good old Caesar Augustus gives an order that all the world should be taxed, and it actually was a census. Everybody was to go to their hometown and be counted. There were two reasons for that. One was taxation. The other was conscription. In case he needed some more soldiers, we got a good list of all the young men, and we'll force them into service if we choose. And so for Mary and Joseph, this created a situation because they had to travel about 100 miles. And it was not like hopping in your car and driving 100 miles. It was 100 miles on foot and with a donkey. And there they go. And so the hardship of that was unbelievable. And then when they finally wind up in Bethlehem, as we read in the story, there's no room in the inn. And they wind up in a stable with Mary delivering her baby, the Son of God, under those kind of circumstances. And, you know, I'm not sure, but I kind of got a feeling that very first Christmas, Mary and Joseph were just hoping for Christmas to hurry up and be over. But then Jesus was born. And you see, when we understand that Christmas is when Jesus is born, suddenly all the problems can change. Things can be different. But in spite of that, there are all kinds of things that may hinder you from having the happy Christmas you would like to. So let's look at a couple of things. What can cause us to have a blue Christmas? What can cause us to have a blue Christmas? Well, the first one, I believe, is what we will call unrealistic expectations. You see, we all sing, "I'm dreaming of a white Christmas." Well, if you live in North Carolina, the odds are very slim that you're going to have a white Christmas. You might head up into the mountains and wind up having one. In all of my life, I don't remember but just a few times in North Carolina that we had snow on Christmas. And the one time that I remember we did, I wish we hadn't, because the lights went out and we couldn't cook. And so I'll be honest with you. If I never have a white Christmas, it'll be fine. I can turn on the TV and have all the white Christmas I want. I can watch the movie, I can listen to the song, and I can find the picture. But for some people, that's their idea of a perfect Christmas. But you know, in all honesty, they don't really want a lot of snow because they still want to be able to go where they want to go. They want to be able to do what they want to do. They just want the ambiance of it when they're there. They want it to look Christmassy. Well, maybe they just don't understand that all of that's not going to always work out exactly right. I heard of two older ladies who were doing some shopping at the local Walmart and talking to one another, and somebody walked by and overheard the two of them. And one of them said to the other, "You know, Christmas is that time when we can pretend that we have a normal family for a little while. Thankfully, it only lasts a couple of days." You see, they want to hit them out. Sometimes our expectations are so high that it's almost impossible to hit the mark. The weather has to be perfect. The decorations have to be just right. The food has to taste better than last year. Everybody has to be home, and they have to come with a good mood. Good luck with that. Well, not only can we have unrealistic expectations, we can allow financial pressure to create some problems for us at Christmas. Sometimes folks feel the pressure to give to their family members, and especially to their kids, everything that they ask for. Let me tell you, that's a huge mistake. It's a big mistake. Christmas doesn't have to be the best Christmas ever. You don't have to get everything that you want. In fact, the best thing that can happen for you is not to get everything that you want. And by the way, if you're putting it all on the old credit card, that's a big mistake too. Do you realize there are people that will put themselves in a bind? And I know there are people that sometimes have no choice but to do that to a certain extent. But you can have Christmas without spending a tremendous amount of money. In fact, listen to this passage from Isaiah 55 and 2. "Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy?" Now, the last part of that is really the cue to it. Because do you know that no matter how many things you get, how much you buy, how much you give, you're never really going to be completely satisfied if stuff is what it does. If stuff is what it takes to make you happy, there'll never be enough stuff. You know, I was talking with somebody the other day about this guy that owns Amazon. Do you realize that this year, when we've all been shut down and a lot of people are going bankrupt in their businesses, he's made billions of dollars, just billions of dollars, shipping stuff to your house. Now, if you ride down the road, in fact, I'm convinced that there's not enough time to really deliver stuff. That's the reason they pitch it out the window when they go by. We have stuff that comes to us every day, and the door is unlocked and open, and I'll step out and trip over it, and they drop it off on the sidewalk, and I say, "Hang on, just bring it inside, come on." Especially if it's raining. They throw stuff on the front porch, they throw it wherever they can, and keep rolling because they got so much stuff. The UPS guys are starting before sunrise and working after dark, delivering things. And guess what? That guy's got enough money already. He's got so much money that he could not even. In fact, I believe, I'm not positive about this, but I believe he and his wife split up maybe last year. Each of them took a gazillion dollars with them, and neither one of them noticed it. They neither noticed it. I mean, when you look at your bank account and there's so many zeros that runs off the end of the page, how much do you need? How much do you need? Most of us go to our homes and Lynn and I were laughing the other night. We were watching one of the older movies, and they showed a picture of somebody's house, and they had a little closet that was like this that had their clothes in it, and she said, "That's all the clothes people used to have. You could put them together and stick it right there. You know, we can't get the clothes we're going to wear this week in that little thing." You got to have piles and piles of stuff, stuff that you don't wear, but you still need some more, don't you? So stuff, and we spend so much doing it. Hebrews 13 and 5 says, "Don't love money. Be satisfied with what you have." You know, boy, if we could learn to apply that, it'd make a difference. So your Christmas may be blue because of unrealistic expectations or financial pressure. It may also be blue, and I think this is true for a lot of us, because of an overcommitted schedule. There's only so many hours in the day. There's so many days in the week, and there's only so many days between now and Christmas. And for many of us, our schedule starts filling up. And then especially when you start honing in on Christmas itself. You see, with our family, we're large enough now. We start talking about this back in the summertime. When are we going to do Christmas? Because you got to decide everybody's families, where are they going to get together and when are they going to get together? It kind of starts when you get married. Because up until then, it's just mom and dad and grandparents, if you have grandparents that you do Christmas with. I can remember when I was a youngster growing up, we had Christmas at our house. And then we always went for lunch to my dad's parents, my grandmother and granddaddy Stevens, and then for supper on Christmas Day to my grandmother and granddaddy Godwin. That was regular as it could be. Then I got married. Well, that started creating a problem because my wife's family always got together for Christmas lunch. So now that interfered with one of my grandparents. And sometimes we tried to do both of them. Sometimes we had to go here and there and yonder. And then our kids start getting married. Now you really start adding it up. And for most families, they're just more people and more places to go than you can fit. That's the reason a number of years ago, we decided at our house, we would rather get together the day after Christmas and not have to rush than to try to pile it all into one or two days. And so most years, that's what we do. And now we've added to that, Haley is a nurse. And you might not have noticed, but hospitals are still open on Christmas Day. And so Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, one or the other, almost always she's going to be working. So we work around that. And then you got other families. And she's got a boyfriend. That's not a good idea. We were thinking she was going to stay single all of her life. And now that's another family thrown in there. So you see, when you do all that, now your schedule's full. And that's just family. Now, what about if you got kids and in a normal year, they would have something going on at school. They got friends they want to get together with. You got a work party or maybe two work parties if both of you work. And before long, the schedule is full. Let me tell you something. You cannot do everything. You just cannot do everything. If you add something to your schedule, you got to take something off. And if you don't learn to do that, you're going to be frustrated, and an overcommitted schedule can cause you to have a blue Christmas. And then one last thing that I thought about, and that's family conflict. You just might have a Clark Griswold family. You know, Cousin Eddie shows up without being invited. And generally when they come, they bring somebody with them, don't they? You may have parents, grandparents, in-laws, whatever, that have outlaws, whatever. And they just aren't normal. They're not normal. They're strange people. You may even have brothers and sisters or even your husband or wife, and of course then their family, and you mix all that stuff in there, and getting a family together, oh wow, you're talking about potential problems. I read about one young father that was describing to a friend what it's like now he's married. He said, every Christmas we drive 500 miles to endure 3 days of criticism. They complain about how we raise our kids, what kind of church we attend, and if we didn't go, they'd complain that we didn't go. He said, I don't even want to go. But guess what? They're the only family you got. They're the only family you got, and that's a part of it. But it's easy for us to think that we're the only ones who have that problem. Read the Bible stories. Think about Joseph and his coat of many colors, and his brothers were so jealous because he had that coat. They sold him into slavery. Some of them wanted to kill him. They sold him into slavery. God used that slavery actually to deliver them. He winds up in Egypt. A number of years later, they come and they reconcile with one another, and he sends them home to go get their dad. And you know what the last thing he told them on the way out the door? Genesis 45:24, don't get in an argument on the way home. He knew them well enough that he knew they could not leave from where they were and go home and get their dad and come back without probably starting a fight. So it's just a part of family. And those kinds of things can cause you to have a blue Christmas if you're not careful. But it doesn't have to be that way. How is it that you can have a Christmas that is merry and bright, as the song says? Well, I think the first thing is you change the way you think about Christmas. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 12 about how as Christians we ought to be different than people in this world. And the second verse reads this way: don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for your life, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Now, we don't normally think about that being a Christmas verse, but let me tell you, that's some advice about how to have a happy Christmas. If you quit thinking like the world and copying the behavior of the world and instead become the person that God wants you to be, you will find that your mind is changed and you suddenly learn to know, he says, what is God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Now, the passage of scripture we read earlier today is in the latter part of the first chapter of the book of Luke. Now, those of you that have been in Sunday school, this is sandwiched between the story of Zechariah having an angel appear to him and Mary having an angel appear to her, because this story is the story of the birth of John the Baptist. When you read that passage of scripture, don't get confused that it's about Jesus. It's not. It's about John the Baptist. When John the Baptist was born, he was a miracle child. I don't know if I mentioned it last week. We talked about it Wednesday night in our Bible study, though. The Lord sent the angel Gabriel to Zacharias and told him that you and Elizabeth are going to have a miracle child. They were too old to have children. You're going to have a baby, and that baby is going to be a special baby. And this is a passage of scripture that tells of the praise that Zacharias gave when he was able to speak again. And if you remember that story, when he questioned the angel, he said, how do I know this is going to happen? The angel said, you're going to not be able to speak until after the baby is born. And the first thing that he spoke was these words of praise for the birth of John the Baptist. And when John was born, they asked his mother, what's he going to be named? And said, name him John. They said, you can't name him John. You don't have any Johns in your family. And Zacharias asked for a tablet and wrote on it, said, his name is John. When he did that, he had fulfilled the thing God had asked him to do, and he was restored the ability to speak. And immediately, he didn't say, boy, I'm glad that's over with. He didn't complain about what had happened. He began to praise God for what he was doing. And that passage of scripture that we read this morning was that. And listen to part of this, verse 66 through 68. Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and gave this prophecy: praise the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has visited and redeemed his people. Now, when you start, how you're going to change how you think about it, we go back to the same things. The first one is that you adjust your expectations. People who struggle the most with their emotions at Christmas are because they expect the wrong things and they want the wrong kind of things. They want Christmas to be perfect. But what they really mean is they want it to be perfect for them. They want everything about Christmas to be what they want it to be. And if you're that kind of person, if you're a perfectionist in everything and it always has got to be perfect in your estimation, you're going to live a very frustrated life. Because what you think is perfect, somebody else will not think is perfect. And unless you're going to live completely by yourself, you're going to find conflict as a part of that. And so give your family a break. You're not the Waltons. It's not going to be like that at your house. You probably don't cook like Martha Stewart or one of them other people. You do the best you can. The food will be great. Everybody will enjoy it if you'll just allow them to. And the truth is, somebody's going to show up and do something you don't like, and they're going to rub you the wrong way. But somebody came up with the idea that I like, and that is that everything you're dealing with, use what's called the 5x5 rule. And that is, if it won't make a difference 5 years from now, don't spend more than 5 minutes worrying about it. If it won't make a difference 5 years from now, don't spend more than 5 minutes worrying about it. You know, we spend so much of our time upset and worried about things that really are not going to make any difference. Instead of asking the question, what will this Christmas be like for me? What if you ask the question, what will I be like this Christmas? Is there something I can do? Can I change something about me that'll make a difference in how I experience this Christmas? I read a review of a book that was written by a lady named Laura Schroff. It's called An Invisible Thread, and it's a story of a female executive that worked with USA Today newspaper. One day she was walking down the road, and she walked by an 11-year-old homeless boy who asked her for some help. And she walked by him. She said, but when I got a few steps past, I couldn't stop. I couldn't keep going, and I stopped. And I turned around and went back. And I kept going back. That day, she took him to McDonald's and bought him lunch. Later, she took him to a place and bought some better clothes for him to wear to school. She took him to a ball game with the New York Mets, took him to hear the opera, carried him out to some fancy restaurants, and helped him to experience things he never would have been able to experience otherwise. She made sure that he was provided for as he grew up through the years. She took him to family gatherings. She made him a part of her family and her life. 15 years later, she celebrated her 50th birthday. And he was there, and he was asked to speak, and this is what he said. He said, "You saved my life. The Lord sent an angel to me, and that angel's you." Now, that's a misuse of the word angel, of course, but in many ways, you can be that. There's somebody that you will come in contact with probably this Christmas that you can change their life. There's people all around us that they've had a tougher year than we've had. I don't care how tough your year's been. They've had a tougher year than you've had. Things are going bad for them. There's a lot of people that their jobs have been impacted, their businesses have been impacted, all because of what's happened in relation to the virus and the shutdowns that have been a part of it, and schools and all those kinds of things have been hurt by it. There's just all kinds of people around that are struggling, and Christmas is coming, and every year that passes, there's people around us that for them, Christmas is not a happy time because they are not able to do what they wish they could do. You can make a difference in somebody's life. Zechariah revealed why the Messiah was coming. In verse 74 and 75 of that same passage, he says, "We have been rescued from our enemies so that we can serve God without fear in holiness and righteousness for as long as we live." Why did God save you? God saved you to save you from an eternal separation from him in a place called hell, but he did not save you to live your life simply strolling along grateful that you're not like the other people that are around you. I believe God saves every one of us to become involved in the lives of people that are around us. Not only are you going to come in contact with people that maybe are financially struggling, but you're going to come in contact with a lot of people that are emotionally hurting. And you're going to come in contact with even more people that are spiritually wandering. So you see, they don't know what Christmas is all about. They don't understand it. And so you will change your expectations. You will adjust your or alter your obligations. And then I think you will do something, and that is you will select your celebrations. You see, how we celebrate Christmas changes everything. You can go to all the parties you want to, and if you go to the wrong kind of party, you may wind up wearing a lampshade, and you may come home forgetting what happened. I hope you don't go to that kind of party. But if that's what your party involves, you're not celebrating the birthday of Jesus. You're celebrating the excess of this world. You realize that the last time that Christmas fell on December the 25th, many churches just canceled church altogether that day. Didn't have any activities at all. Now, I don't have a problem with trying to adjust schedules to accommodate family activities. And I know in some cases, people are traveling and they're away somewhere else and they're not able to be here. But I can promise you, as long as I'm the pastor of this church, when December the 25th comes on Sunday, we're going to celebrate Christmas right here. And if your celebration of Christmas involves all the things the world wants you to do and completely ignores Jesus, what kind of celebration of his birth is that? And sadly, for most of the world, that's why Christmas is never going to measure up, because you're celebrating the wrong thing. You see, if you celebrate the fact that Jesus came to this world, Jesus gave his life on the cross of Calvary for me. Jesus offers to save me for eternity. Jesus offers through the Holy Spirit to come into my life and every day to guide me and to help me to live a life that not only has meaning for me, but has an influence and an impact in the lives of other people. Suddenly Christmas can be perfect with nothing. Don't need stuff. Now, stuff is nice. Now, I don't want to get you wrong about that. You know, we all have fun opening gifts. I'll be honest with you, I have reached a point in my life that I really do enjoy giving gifts better than I do getting gifts. I don't need anything. Finding somebody else that does need something and helping them out with it, man, that's worth something. That's a lot of fun. And I believe that's part of what Christmas ought to be for every one of us. The opportunity to do something for somebody else. My wife shared a story on Facebook a couple of weeks ago. A lot of you probably saw it, about a little boy. I won't tell you the whole story because I couldn't remember it and couldn't tell it exactly right. But it was a little boy that Christmas was coming and he had wanted a rifle. They were living tough times and he really wanted that rifle. And his dad came to him and had told him ahead of time, it's just not going to happen this year. Financially, we're not able to do it. But he came the evening of Christmas Eve and he asked his son, he said, put your boots and your coat back on. We're going outside. And he was a little bit perturbed because things weren't going the way he wanted to. And they went outside and they loaded up a bunch of wood in their wagon. And he said, what are we doing with this wood? He said, we're going to carry it down to a lady who's a widow. Her husband died this year. She's got four kids and she's not doing too well right now. And so they went down there, and before they left, he went inside and the mother had fixed some food. Had a ham and some other things prepared to go. And they started to go out. And he said, wait a minute, I forgot something. And went out and got a bag and said, what's in the bag? He said, well, it's some clothes and some shoes and some things for the children. And they went there. And along the way, this little boy got to thinking, yeah, man, I've never thought about not having clothes to wear or shoes to wear. I've never thought about that. And they got there. And he said, when they got there that evening and knocked on the door, and that lady came and went inside and the fire was almost gone because they were out of firewood. And he said, I'll take care of that. And starts loading in armloads of firewood, gets that roaring fire going. Brings the food in, sets it on the table, and then comes in with the packages and watches as those little kids open up those things. And he said on the way home, my dad told me, he said, son, I'm sorry, but I actually had sold something to get the money to get your rifle. But when I realized the situation this family was in, I thought that was a better use of the money. And the little boy who had grown up and was remembering this back, he said, I've never forgot that. He said, it's the best Christmas I ever had. To find somebody else that has a need, and whether it's a need of financial, whether it's a need of just a kind word of encouragement. You know, nowadays with all of what's going on, we're not supposed to hug or anything. But sometimes somebody just needs a good hug. They need somebody to say, hey, I'm thinking about you. I love you. Can I help you? and then to do it. And I believe when we do that, we fulfill that which Jesus said to us, that in that you've done it to the least of me is my brethren, you did it to me. I promise you, you live your Christmas that way, you will not have a blue Christmas. Let's pray. God, we thank you that Christmas for us has all the meaning of knowing that our Savior was born, but it can have all the meaning of knowing that the things that are most important can fit into our schedule, and some of the things that really don't matter may need to be taken out. That we may be able to change what our expectations and our hopes and our wishes are to things that really do matter. And that we might be able to embrace and share with people that we love the goodness of God's love in our lives as we share it with others. Now, Lord, I pray if there's one that's listening now that's never trusted your Savior, right now might be the time they say yes to Jesus. Whatever need it is, help us to trust you with it. Meet those needs for our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. You have a need, whatever it might be, invite you to bring it to the Lord as we stand together and sing.